was your experience like working on Doctor Strange?
Yeah, obviously to be part of a big film like that is brilliant. And I was a big fan of the Marvel comics, not of Doctor Strange, but Marvel comics in general. You know, I read Spider-Man and Captain America and all the usual stuff. So to be part of a big movie like that was a thrill. I really enjoyed working with Benedict and Mads Mikkelsen. And yeah, I'm used to working at a much quicker pace, so it was nice to relax and have some nice big sets. We could finesse things, we didn't have to rush it. And even for the stunt work, you know, on the lower budget movies, you're fighting on whatever is you've managed to get, hard floor, concrete, steel. And on something like Doctor Strange, there's they take the time to pad the set and make things easier for you. If you're going to fall down the stairs, they'll cover it with foam and things like that. So, yeah, it's easier. I don't think Doctor Strange is a conventional hero, is he? So he's perfect to play that sort of part. I mean, it was important to get an actor that could pull off the intelligence, the arrogance, the... No, I mean, he's not an arrogant person, but he does it with Sherlock, right? He plays that arrogant guy in Sherlock. And it's very similar with Doctor Strange. You know, he's a lot like Tony Stark. Benedict's a great guy, really down to earth, extremely intelligent. And, you know, the fight stuff was new to him. He'd done it a little bit in Star Trek. And to his credit, he knew a bit about what I'd done, that I'd done a lot of that stuff. And I was able to give him some advice on some of it. And, you know, we worked as a partnership. And, of course, we've got stunt doubles and all the rest of it and a great fight coordinator. And he worked really hard. It's not easy being doing action films. And... especially when you're the lead. So it was a tough old slog for him, especially coming off Hamlet, which he'd done for however many months directly before that. And while he was still performing Hamlet, he was actually having to come to the studios and rehearse all the fights. So the guy's a workaholic. I mean, he doesn't stop working, right? So he was brilliant, and he did a fabulous job.
There was a big grassroots campaign to get you cast as Iron Fist. Did you ever have any conversations with Marvel about that? Is there any chance of that happening?
I did, yeah. I spoke to them about it. And I think the general consensus was that I was too old, which is fair enough. I'm 40 now, and Danny Rand needed to be early 20s because, you know, he's a kid when he goes to the lost city of Kunlun. And he's there for ten years until the dimension opens up, right, or something like that, whatever. So he needed to be in his early 20s, so that went against me. And I'm not blonde. Not a lot I could do about that, but we could have done the website, Scott Adkins, not Danny Rand or something, but yeah, hair dye, yeah.
You sum up what's the best part of your career so far and what you want going forward probably over the next 20 years?
I'll tell you, that's a good question right now, because when I was 15, I got this comic book called Accident Man. And I loved it. I thought it was a great British comic book. Not very well known, but I loved it when I read it as a kid. So I always had this idea in the back of my head that I wanted to make it into a movie. So about 3 years ago, I optioned the property and I wrote the script with a friend from school. We wrote it together, Stu Small. I've produced it, co-wrote it, starred in it, and we're just going through the whole post-production process at the moment. And bringing that comic to life as a movie and having it be my dream since I was a kid has been an amazing experience for me. And the whole process of making the film, you know, getting the money there, getting it produced, actually shooting it, and now going through the post-production. Was at Pinewood yesterday seeing the... You know, they were doing the colour grading and, you know, going in for the sound mix and all this stuff. It's a fascinating process.
Is it like a learning curve for you?
Yeah, that side of filmmaking, after you've shot the movie, I've not really got much experience with. So to be on that side of it now has been really interesting. You know, and I get the composer sends over new pieces of music and we're able to put it in and and see how the film's taking shape and everybody is delivering on this movie. It is a movie made on a budget for sure, but I'm really very happy with it, very proud of it so far. And of all the films I've done, it's got the most of my personality in it, you know, having written it. And it's extremely British. I'm really proud of it, and I think it's going to do well. Touch wood, eh? We don't know, but I'm really enjoying it, and hopefully if I enjoy it, other people will. And excited. Not yet, but we're getting to that. But end of this year, beginning of next year, we'll see. But we've got some great people in it: Ray Stevenson, David Paymer, Michael Jai White, Nick Moran. Very, very excited about that film. So that was a good question.
What did you learn when you worked on Expendables, especially with the type of talent and cast and their influence in that genre?
Yeah, obviously everyone was a king of his field, right? And to see people like Stallone and Schwarzenegger and Bruce Willis doing their thing, just to watch them and see how they were on set, you know, their work ethic and things like that, you would learn a lot from them. And, you know, they're very precious about their image and what is captured on screen, which is important, you know, because they know how to make themselves look good. And I learned something there, to be honest. Of course, you know, time is your enemy with something like that. Sometimes you've only got one take and you've got to move on because you're not going to have a film if you don't. But yeah, I learned a lot from those guys. Normally, you're always fighting for time making a film. If you're making a Bond movie, you've probably got 6 months, right? So, but even then, you're going to be struggling. There's never enough time. But because I do a lot of independent movies, we certainly don't have the time. And it's worse now because of the piracy issue. So sometimes you're making a film in 3 weeks or less, and that film still has to be an hour and 30 minutes long. I almost feel like with the piracy issue now, we should be allowed to make films that are 1 hour, 15 minutes. You know, because it's so, so difficult. It's cheaper to make films now, but they don't make as much money as they used to, unless they have a theatrical run. So it's, time is money.
So you don't mean there's no Mariah Carey diva shot from Bruce Willis because he didn't want to be shot from his left-hand side?
I couldn't comment on that, could I? I couldn't possibly comment on that. I honestly didn't see anything like that. Next question. Yeah, we've got a big problem, and the distributors really need to catch up in the way things are done because everything's changed. So if you're releasing a film in Russia and then it doesn't come out anywhere else for 3 months, guess what? It's going to be on the internet. And the people that want to see the movie, if he's French or whatever, living in the other side of the world, he's going to get that torrent that was released from Russia. And it's probably not in the Russian language. It probably is in English or whatever. So they need to release films worldwide on the same date. That needs to be sorted out, absolutely. That problem has happened with my latest film. It's on the internet 6 months before it's released. And no, that isn't an invitation to go and download it. So they need to sort that out. And I think it's a problem that's not going to go away, because the most frustrating issue is that people seem to think it's a victimless crime and they don't even realize it's a crime. Oh, I'm just going to watch it because, the big man Hollywood guy in his ivory tower, it's not going to affect him. Well, it affects people like me, and it affects people like that are general workers on independent movies. You know, they're going to get paid less because they can't afford to make the movie any other way. Budgets are being crunched. And people need to realize, if you enjoy watching genre movies, independent movies, you need to support it with money. And if you don't, those films are going to go away. There's more and more franchises out there, more and more, you know, there's less. People are taking less chances on interesting films. It needs to be a sequel or a franchise, whatever. And that's partly because of the piracy issue. So support films. And if you did download it because you couldn't wait 6 months, okay, I get it. But make sure when the film comes out, buy the Blu-ray, buy the DVD, get it on iTunes, show your support. And then we can continue to make these films.
What
advice would you give to someone wanting to get into the stunts industry? Because it seems to be a very hard thing to get into nowadays.
If you want to become a stuntman, you better be tough, because it's you're going to get hurt, you're going to get smashed up. You know, there's people that die doing it. There's a reason why it's called stunts. It's not easy. If you want to be famous and you think being a stuntman is going to get you that, then don't bother, you know, because, you know, the stunt guys are supposed to stay in the background. You know, remember the Fall Guy theme tune? I'm the unknown stuntman. That's the way it should be, you know, but there's people want to get famous from it now. Now, the job of the stuntman is to create the illusion of that character doing that stunt. But of course, I do love to watch actors that can do their own stuff, because, you know, I'm one of those guys, so I'm biased. But yeah, but if you want to be a stuntman, go for it. But it's hard. It's very hard. Vic Armstrong. Oh, yeah, big influence. Actually, I've done a few films. The director of Accident Man is Jesse Johnson. He's actually the nephew of Vic Armstrong. So I did a film with Jesse this time last year, and I got to meet Vic Armstrong for the first time, and then straight away ended up doing a film with him, American Assassin, the Michael Keaton, Dylan O'Brien movie. So I got to work with Vic as a second unit director on that. But yeah, legendary stuntman, read the book. Great guy as well, down to earth. Brilliant, brilliant director, knows exactly what he wants, prepared.
He's got the years and influence.
Oh, God, yeah. He's been around, he knows what to do. This guy did all the Bond movie, second unit. He was the Indiana Jones' stunt guy. Pretty much did all the stuff for Harrison Ford in the Temple of Doom because he hurt his back. Whatever, I'm giving it away, sorry. Just said I wouldn't do that. Yeah, Vic Armstrong is great.
Who were the action heroes growing up, let's say the Sylvester Stallones, the Van Dammes, who were the guys that you looked up to and modelled your maybe career on or aspired to get to that level?
Bruce Lee, Stallone, Van Damme, Jackie Chan, Schwarzenegger, all the action guys. And my favourite actor was always, two guys, Gary Oldman, who I got to work with recently, and Anthony Hopkins. But, you know, the list goes on. The list goes on and on. Well, The Expendables, it was kind of like Stallone and my peers saying, you know, well done, kid. You've earned your stripes. Come and be part of the gang in The Expendables. It was like you got a badge of honor for being an action guy. That's the way I looked at it, and it was really cool. Loved it. It can be like that. It can be a lot of fun. It can be a walk in the park. It can be like play school. But other times, it can be really difficult. Making action films is really hard. It seemed like a good idea when I was 12. But what I found out is that it is tough. And if you're going to do it right, if you're going to do it properly, if you're going to try and do as much of your own stunts as you can, and, you know, all your own fights, and to keep raising the bar and to keep outdoing yourself, and now you've got to do it with less time because there's less money. It's really difficult, but I'm very driven in that way. And one thing no one can take away from me is that I work really hard. I think I get that work ethic from my parents because they worked very hard. You know, they were, you know, normal people who just grafted away all their lives, and I saw that. And I've got a strong work ethic. And listen, I'm privileged to do what I do. I don't take it for granted. And I'm petrified that it will be took away from me as well. So I always give it my best shot. And I think you can see every film I'm improving. I've not rested on my laurels. So yeah, I'm fortunate.
Back from Thailand doing Triple Threat, what's it like working with foreign crews? Because you did Wolf Warrior with Wu Jing. When you're in a different country and working with a foreign crew, what's that like for you personally?
Well, there's always the broken, lost in translation situation, but I have to say I really love working in Thailand because the crew works really, really hard. And obviously, I love making films in the UK and America, but those pesky unions, they can get in the way You know, I know they're supposed to be looking after people, but so you know, it's so hard, especially when you're making a film on a short schedule. It's so hard to make an hour and 40 minutes. So you got to push, you got to push. And in Thailand, they'll work really hard for you, that crew, and the same in China. So you lose a little bit with it lost in translation, but you gain a hell of a lot with just hard-working crews. I'll give Shakespeare a go, yeah. We did that at... No, I went to drama school, you know. Played Laertes, played Benedict in Midsummer Night's Dream. Much Ado About Nothing. So I'd give that a go. I'll give anything a go. I really like to work. I probably work more than I should. There's a few projects maybe I should have turned down. But, you know, I just... again, it's a privilege and I enjoy to keep working. Well, this isn't why I wanted to get into the film business or to be an actor. That was something that I had inside me as a kid, you know, a real fire within myself, something I just had to do, a calling. As you know, I'm very passionate about this. But these things are great. The Comic-Con's quite a new thing, isn't it? You know, yeah, but it's not been around for that many years. It feels like that to me, the whole cosplay thing and everything. And you know the landscape of the cinema today is so many of these comic book movies, so it really works out. I'm a big fan of Star Wars and comic book movies and all the rest of it, like everybody else. Yeah, you want to do it because it's cool. Yeah, so.
Is there a upcoming franchise you've got your eye on? Bond, Star Wars, Fast and Furious.
I'd love to be in Star Wars, of course. Oh my God, could you imagine that?
Get Warwick to give you a good word to Kathleen Kennedy.
Oh, get him around the scruff of the neck. Oi, Warwick, who've got to talk to? Yeah, do it, man. God, you're bringing over people from the other side of the world. I live in Birmingham. You're filming it in Pinewood and Shepperton. Come on, I'll be a Knight of Ren or whatever. Where's the phone call?